Welcome to Oklahoma Gardening. On today's program, we travel to Southwood Landscape and Garden Center in Tulsa, Oklahoma, to visit with the gardening guy, Paul James, about some great plants for soggy conditions. Back in the garden, Casey unboxes a micro spray irrigation kit and installs it in some of our raised beds. And we take a look at fasciation. Oklahoma Gardening is a production of the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the land-grant mission of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University, dedicated to improving the quality of life of the citizens of Oklahoma through research-based information. Underwriting assistance is provided by TLC, Oklahoma's leading garden center, Southwood Landscape and Garden Center, Tulsa's source for great gardens, southwoodgardencenter.com. And the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry, helping to keep Oklahoma green and growing.
We are here at Southwood Nursery, and joining me today is the gardener guy, Paul James. Thank you for joining us.
My pleasure, Casey.
I'm so excited to be here with you, and you're going to show us some plants that are tolerant of soggy soils, which is perfect because the sun is starting to come out finally. But what do we have to look at?
Well, there's a number of situations where people have a spot in their yard where, you know, maybe it stays wet all the time, or maybe it just stays wet for a week or two following heavy rains.
Right.
A lot of plants won't grow with wet feet like that. So I want to focus on plants that will do really well in those soggy sites. But the bonus is they also do really well when it dries out.
Perfect. Perfect for Oklahoma.
So, as the name would suggest, river birch.
Likes water.
Exactly. And this, I'm so excited about this, a relatively new introduction called Fox Valley.
Right.
Betula nigra Fox Valley. The cool thing about this, 8x8 is its ultimate size.
Excellent. So it'd be great for a small backyard. I mean, you can see it doesn't look as much like a tree. It's more of a shrub.
Exactly. But it still develops that beautiful exfoliating bark that is a key feature in the full-size tree.
Right.
So rather than have this giant tree in your yard, if you like river birch, you can still have one and just go with the shrub form.
Perfect.
I love this.
That looks great. What else do you have?
Okay, one of my absolute favorites, and yours too, apparently.
Yes.
Taxodium disticum, the bald cypress.
The bald cypress.
Now, these are native to swamps.
Mm-hmm.
Louisiana swamps, if you've ever seen them growing, and they develop those knees.
Right.
Which are terrible on lawnmower blades. But these, they'll not only thrive in water, standing water, but if it dries out, they also adapt readily to dry conditions.
Right, and this was actually an Oklahoma proven plant.
Yep.
Which is nice. Some of the plants you're showing us are easy to find in nurseries.
Yes. But in this group, this is a fairly new introduction. This is called Peave Minaret.
Mm-hmm.
I love this. I have three of these.
It's going to be a dwarf also, right?
It's a dwarf cultivar. There's still actually some disagreement on its ultimate height. I'm putting it at about 8 feet.
Okay.
But only about 2 feet wide.
Excellent.
So you get that, again, great for a small property, a little courtyard, even does well in containers.
So these are tree genus, but they're both dwarf.
Right. And, you know, they do so well here. I mean, they've been on the planet since, like, the Triassic, Jurassic. So,
right.
You know, it's a pretty rugged plant.
There's a reason it outlasted the dinosaurs,
exactly,
right?
Exactly.
All right, well, let's go take a look at some more that you have for us.
Let's go that way.
So, Paul, speaking of natives, we have the Yaupon holly here.
Yes, and I don't think a lot of people realize that this will tolerate a really wet spot.
Right.
And, you know, you've got the more familiar form,
mm-hmm.
and then you've got weepers, and, you know, you got those beautiful berries. So, another great choice. I love them.
And there's also a Nana Yaupon.
Right,
so
right.
So does it do well in soggy conditions?
Not as well.
Okay.
Not as well. But, you know, one of the things I've always liked about this more than anything else is its Latin name.
Ilex vomitoria.
I just love that. Who says botanists don't have a sense of humor?
And you can limb this up too, as
absolutely,
well.
Absolutely.
So you can kind of create more shape with it.
I actually have a neighbor who for years had done that radical formal pruning, you know?
Right.
And one day he saw mine and he goes, how do I get mine to look like yours? And I said, stop pruning. And so he did, and it's been like 2 years now. It looks beautiful.
Great.
It's gone back to its, you know, its natural form, and it's really pretty.
Right, they're a great plant.
I love them.
Excellent.
Okay, there's more. So, Casey, not a real well-known plant, I don't think.
Right.
Wax myrtle.
Right.
This is just an amazing plant from the standpoint of it will grow anywhere.
Okay.
It will grow fast, up to 5 feet a year if it really likes where it is. It's an evergreen. It's got aromatic foliage and berries.
Mm-hmm.
The berries in colonial times were used to make bayberry candles. Bayberry is another name for it.
Right.
I mean.
And it's an Oklahoma proven.
And it's an Oklahoma proven. Maybe some hardiness issues in certain parts of the state, but it's performing really well in the Tulsa area. So.
Right. Okay.
I don't know. It's. I'll be the first to admit, it's not the most beautiful thing in the world, but when it comes to solving problems, because people want fast growing evergreens,
right,
and there really aren't that many,
mm-hmm,
this is certainly one that'll fit the bill and will just grow in wet soil, dry soil, heavy clay. It doesn't matter.
Southern wax myrtle.
Yes.
Sounds like an ideal plant for that situation.
Yes.
That you're just not sure about.
And for years it's been in the genus Myrica.
Uh-huh.
They're moving it to Morella.
Okay.
Those taxonomists, like they don't have anything better to do.
It's hard to keep up with them.
I mean,
sometimes.
We give them credit for Ilex vomitoria,
right,
but I don't know why they want to change it. Anyway, that's a nice one. And speaking of names that need to be changed,
yes.
I got
another
one to show you.
Excellent.
Okay, so this is one where I'm going to throw you a curve, maybe.
All right.
It's called black gum. Okay.
Okay.
But the problem with naming any tree gum.
People want to chew it, right?
Worse, they think of sweet gum and they don't want a sweet gum anymore because those seed pods are so,
ugh. Okay.
The black gum, its real name, and we're going to change the name on all our signs, Tupelo.
Tupelo.
Yes.
Okay.
It's a much prettier name, and the bees love the flowers.
Like Tupelo honey.
You got it.
Excellent.
But this is, what an amazing tree. Very underused in this area. Very underused. It'll grow in wet soils. It'll grow in dry soils. This is wildfire. This will get about 30 feet or so.
Okay.
And then the species more like 40 to 50. But a great landscape tree. Fall foliage is unbelievable.
Red color?
Yes.
Okay.
Almost like you plugged it in.
Really?
I mean, it just is spectacular. This is one of those, the fall colors such that people will stop, knock on your door and say, what is that tree out there?
That's fabulous. We're always looking for additional fall color.
Yeah, I mean, very underused, rugged as all get out. This thing is tough as nails. So great for any setting. And the smaller one will adapt well to smaller yards. If you've got plenty of land, then you can go with the big one.
Okay, great. So Paul, it looks like we've got a willow here.
Yes.
It's amazing, some of the different willows, and you have one in particular here.
I love this one because, you know, willows typically get pretty large.
Right.
And you see them growing around farm ponds and they look great in landscape settings. But this is golden sunshine. Two things I like about it. The more golden color.
Yeah.
But the size. 15 by 7 or so. A shrub.
Okay. So it's going to have kind of a globe shape to it. Not the weeping willow that a lot of times
Correct.
We're used to seeing. But this bright yellow foliage to it.
Right.
Very
and
nice.
Just well contained, you know, not difficult to grow, loves the moisture.
Right.
All you want to give it. So a great choice. You know, a lot of plants, we need more smaller versions of familiar large plants.
Right.
Because so many properties are smaller
Getting,
these days.
Having smaller backyards. And this is a multi-stem.
Yes.
So could you train it into a single stem?
You probably could. I've never seen it in a tree form, but it'd be worth a try. Yeah, why not?
All right, golden sunshine willow.
Okay, speaking of shrubs.
Yes.
My favorite shrub in the whole world is coming up.
Oh, goodness. Paul, it looks like we have a sweet spire here.
I just love little Henry.
It's a great one.
Itea virginica, Henry's garnet sweet spire. I'm telling you, to me, this is as good a four-season shrub as you can get.
Right.
That new foliage comes out. It's just that beautiful light green. Mm-hmm. Then it darkens. You get the panicles of white flowers. These are almost past their prime. But then again, so am I. So, you know, what are you going to do? And then you get amazing fall color and the red stems.
Right. That's what I like, is the contrast between the red stems and the foliage. It's just a perfect plant.
Well-behaved in a drier spot. It will send out runners in a wet area.
So you get bonus plants.
Well, you do. You do. Absolutely. And it's not that hard to just cut them back if you want to. About 3x3. But the cool thing is, these will grow in deep shade as well as full sun.
And they'll light up that shade too. Kind of bring you a little bit of highlight underneath that dark shade of a tree.
I think oakleaf hydrangea is my favorite plant for Oklahoma.
Uh-huh.
This may be running a close second.
Yeah. Okay. Paul, a lot of times people think about ornamental grasses being dry and in a hot condition. You've got one here that does well with soggy feet?
Yes, and I don't think a lot of people realize this. This is a switchgrass.
Right.
Panicum is the genus. And this will tolerate pretty wet soil.
Okay.
I mean, long term.
Excellent.
And another thing I just love about this, you know how the miscanthus and the pentacetus, more familiar ornamental grasses, tend to do this, right?
North wind holds its form, right?
5 feet, and I've never seen it wider than 2 feet.
That's great.
So
it won't cover up your other plants when you plant it next to something.
Exactly. And it looks great as a specimen, looks great in mass.
Right.
I mean, it looks great no matter how you plant it.
And like all ornamental grasses, great winter interest. You leave the foliage on there, easy to care for. You just cut them back in late winter, early spring, and it does its thing.
Why am I here? You know all this.
You can't beat that. Why?
You don't even need me today.
No, this is great. Thank you for sharing.
But this does get a beautiful yellow in the fall. Four season interest. Again, kind of like little Henry over there.
Right.
You know, you can enjoy these and they don't need fertilizer. You know, water them well the first year, get them established. Beyond that, they thrive on neglect.
Yes.
That's what I love about
it. That's perfect for us low maintenance gardeners.
Absolutely.
Right?
This defines low maintenance.
Excellent. So it looks like a grass, but it's actually a sedge, right?
That's right. The genus Carex. These, I think, also very underused,
mm-hmm.
And kind of give you that ground cover, grassy kind of look.
Right. It doesn't get much taller than this.
Right, right. But you've got this beautiful variegation. You know, here you got the yellowy cream color, and you've got the white on the edges.
Right.
So a lot of interest. And look, yours has got some volunteers, it looks like. Oh, well, we'll deal with
bonus
that later.
Yeah.
But yeah, I love these, and they're great in mass. Great border plant.
I think they look really great as mass. And again, you mentioned the color, the variegation. It helps highlight some of those shady spots, too.
Bingo.
Perfect.
Now, right next to us here, we have the ferns.
Yes.
So ferns, all the ferns will do okay in a moist environment.
Mm-hmm.
But the ostrich and the cinnamon will tolerate really wet areas. I'm out of ostrich ferns today, but some cinnamon ferns we've got. And those, I mean, seriously, I mean, wet is fine.
So these are the ones you'd put next to your leaky faucet,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. Exactly.
When you have a leaky faucet and you haven't got around to fixing it, if it is in shady conditions,
right.
It's great for that area where it's going to stay constantly moist.
Yeah, I just love them. I love that woodland look and feel, the softness and gentleness. I don't know. I've just always been attracted to ferns.
Perhaps plant it under your bald cypress.
Exactly.
Very good.
Another gymnosperm. It's been around for a long, long time.
Bring in the dinosaurs. Well, it looks like you've shown us everything, every situation. Sun, shade, large, small backyard. There is something for the soggy location.
There really is. And it's too bad that a lot of people think they can't solve the problem.
Right.
When in fact, there are a lot of solutions to those problems.
Thank you for sharing those solutions with us.
My pleasure.
Now we're we're still into spring, but now is the time you want to start thinking about how you're going to water your garden. This is not something you want to figure out when it's blazing hot in August. You want to do this now. And what I want to walk you through today is an irrigation kit. A lot of times when we talk about irrigation and we start thinking about plumbing parts and this and that, and it can get a little scary. But these are kits that you can buy and they're readily available. And they come with all the essential parts that you need to get started. Now, I'll kind of walk you through what some of those things are. You first have your backflow preventer. And this is what you hook up to your faucet. This is important so that the water doesn't go back into the faucet. You also have your half inch poly faucet fitting. So this will hook to your hose bib and then to the provided black poly pipe. You also have a T. You also have a coupling in case you want to splice this pipe. And then end crimpers are available as well. You have your hole punch, and this is going to be what you use to punch your pipe to then insert these misters. Okay, so these will go into your garden, and there's different spray mist nozzles provided so you can get a different range with your water. And then this is the most important thing. You've got a few oops plugs. Now, you're only allowed to have four per kit. So important thing to know is you can buy more. Now, there's a lot of other parts that you can buy to adapt your kit. One thing you want to make sure if your kit doesn't come with it is a pressure regulator. We've gone ahead and purchased this to install with our kit. And what this does is it regulates the pressure out of the faucet so you don't blow out your nozzles. The other thing that you'll want to purchase if it doesn't come with your kit is this little filter. You can see that it's got a metal filter inside there, and that's going to keep any little tiny debris or sand from going through those nozzles and clogging them. We're just simply going to hook these together and then attach our backflow valve. And this is what we will connect to our faucet. Then we also have our half inch poly faucet fitting that we will screw on to this side. And now we're ready to go. We'll simply hook up our black poly tubing to this and simply attach this to our faucet bib, and we're ready to install our irrigation system. So one thing you want to do when you've got all of your pieces laid out is go ahead and, this is really a good step to do in the beginning, carefully cut. You don't want to cut your pipe, you just want to cut the plastic that's holding it tight. Cut that off and go ahead and open up your pipe because it has been curled up for a while, and so it's going to want to stay in this curled shape, as you can see. So what you'll want to do is stretch this out a bit, and you can see over here behind me, we actually have another one that's already stretched out, and that's just going to make it easier to lay it out into your garden. Kind of like us, it melts a little bit in the sun, makes it a little bit more flexible. Before you start cutting your pipe, you want to make sure that you've attached it securely to your water source. That way you know exactly the distance between your water source and where you need to make your first cut. Once we've attached our poly pipe to our faucet, we're going to go ahead and determine where we need to make our first Y. And we're going to simply install this T fitting into our poly pipe across from our first drawer raised bed container. We'll do this by cutting the poly pipe, and then just like you attached it to the faucet, you're simply going to push these on as tight as you can get them, and then push the other one on as well, tight as you can. You can use both of them against each other, and then once you have them on securely, twist these caps down over the hose and that locks them into place. And then that gives us our Y or our T now to branch off to go to our first raised bed. Another thing that's kind of handy to have are these landscape pins. These probably don't come with your kit, they didn't come with ours. But they're nice to go ahead and stake down your poly pipe so that you can keep your spacing consistent and you also know where to put your next tee or split. Now, after we have our splits in place, it's time to go ahead and put in our side pipes that will actually run up to our spray heads. We've bought another roll of poly pipe to do this because we required the whole length of what was provided to go the distance of the containers. So now we again simply place that pipe on there and screw it down into it. And then you bring this up through your containers and you cut it to the distance that you think you'll need. Now this is based off of your spray nozzle, so you might just need one to cover all of this. You might need three, one in each one. It also depends on the type of plants you have. So we're gonna go ahead and cut this to give us plenty of room to about here. And then we will close that, attach our spray nozzles to each of those. You're gonna use the tool provided to poke a hole in the poly pipe. It's pretty simple to go in there. And then you take one end of the mister, and it's on a stake, and put that into your container. And the other end, you push that into the poly pipe, and it locks in there and holds in there pretty securely. And then you're ready to go. After you have all of your pipes connected and your misters attached, the next thing you need to do is flush your line. You want to get that air out before you actually close it. Another way to close these, if you don't have the right purchased equipment, you can also just use a zip tie, fold it over, and then simply zip it tight. And that will keep it from leaking. After you turn on your system and your nozzles are all working, you might look at the spray pattern and see if you have the appropriate nozzle in there. If not, you can simply turn this ball valve off and switch out these nozzles. There are several different ones that come with your kit. They're different colors and it says what the spray patterns are. And you can go and buy additional ones as well. You can simply just screw those back in, turn on your ball valve, and you've changed the spray pattern. Once you have all of your misters adjusted, your garden is summer ready. Attention, something that we discovered here at the entrance of the Botanic Gardens at OSU. This is a plant called Skyrocket, and it's almost past blooming, but what I wanted to show to you was this natural occurring mutation that happens in a wide range of plants. You can see that the width on this stem is much wider and it's flatter than your typical stem. And this mutation is called fasciation. It can happen on a lot of different plants. And the good news is that it's not contagious. It doesn't necessarily harm the plant or anything. It's just a natural occurring phenomenon. What happens is this mutation actually causes the cells to flatten out, creating this banding or ribbing, rather than growing cylindrical, in which they would continue to grow normally. It can be caused by a lot of different things, environmental changes, hormonal imbalances, sometimes viruses and insects, but really, it's not going to harm your plant. If you don't like it, you could simply trim it out of this plant. But it's kind of interesting to be on lookout for this fasciation. Now, you probably have actually seen it and you may not be aware of it, but there are some plants that they've actually selected for fasciation. A lot of your succulents will get fasciation. And here we have an Echinopsis formicrustata, which is been selected for this fasciation. Crestata meaning crested, as you can see it kind of has that crested look. A lot of times succulents are selected for this. Also there's another plant that you're probably familiar with the good old-fashioned coxcomb. That is one plant that has also been selected for the fasciation, and it's actually genetically passed on through the seed. So if you happen to find some fascinating fasciation in your garden, don't be concerned. There's nothing to worry about.
There are lots of great horticultural events this time of year. Be sure and consider these activities when you're making your plans for the weeks ahead. On Oklahoma Gardening, we begin digging into understanding soil fertility with a visit with Extension Nutrient Management Specialist Haylin Zhang. Casey installs a drip irrigation kit, and Barbara Brown cooks dried apricot and garbanzo bean soup. So join us then for more TV you'll grow to love. To find out more information about show topics, as well as recipes, videos, articles, fact sheets, and other resources, including a directory of local extension offices, be sure and visit our website, oklahomagardening.okstate.edu. And we always have great information, answers to questions, photos, and gardening discussions on your favorite social media as well. Join in on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. You can find this entire show and other recent shows, as well as individual segments, on our Oklahoma Gardening YouTube channel. And tune in to our OK Gardening Classics YouTube channel to watch segments from previous hosts. Oklahoma Gardening is produced by the Oklahoma Cooperative Extension Service as part of the Division of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources at Oklahoma State University. The Botanic Garden at OSU is home to our studio gardens, and we encourage you to come visit this beautiful Stillwater jewel. We wish to thank our generous underwriters, TLC Garden Centers, Southwood Landscape and Garden Center, and the Oklahoma Department of Agriculture, Food, and Forestry. Additional support is provided by Pond Pro Shops, Greenleaf Nursery and the Garden Debut Plants, and the Oklahoma Horticultural Society.